sprung up instinctively and started singing to that, you are definitely a true blue Lasallian. Today, we're going to be talking about the history of mission schools and the Lasalle schools' influence in education over time here in Malaysia. There are over 400 primary and secondary mission schools throughout the country, founded and managed by the teaching orders of various Christian churches. This began in 1852 when the De La Salle brothers and Infant Jesus sisters first set foot on Malayan soil. And I couldn't ask for a better guest in talking to us about this. Joining us on the show this evening is...
My name is Brother Anthony Rogers. I'm a La Salle brother, originally from Penang, but I've been in Kuala Lumpur for more than 40 years. I came as a student to study in University of Malaya, and after that, I began teaching in a number of our LaSalle schools.
So before we get into the LaSalle brothers and their schools, could you just give us a little rundown on history? When was the first mission school established in Malaysia, and which was the first mission school?
Yeah, it's interesting you're asking about our first school, but I think a more interesting fact is the person that founded our so-called LaSalle brothers, LaSalle schools, somebody by the name of John Baptist de La Salle. He was in France and he was a priest, but he found during the Industrial Revolution that the parents didn't have time to go to church. They were all in the factories working and they left the kids on the streets. So when he saw the kids on the streets, he said, this is not the place for kids to be. So that's why the whole revolutionary idea of education that was only meant for the rich and the noble and children of the nobles, he started education in a new industrial era. And that was, 330 years ago. And very interestingly, they faced many, many persecutions. Even within France, the brothers were chased out, the communities were closed. But that persecution brought us to Asia. After 150 years in Europe, we came to Asia. And very interestingly, the first school that we began in Asia was in Penang. But before the brothers took over a school that was started by Sir Francis Light, the so-called founder of Penang, because some people say they found him one day on the beach. They didn't found Penang, they found him on the beach. Anyway, so as a result of that, the Francis Light started together with the help of the French priest, first school. It was called St. Francis Xavier's Free School in 1787, 1 year after Francis Light arrived in Penang. And very interestingly, that school, the medium of instruction was Malay.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, because there was a group of so-called Eurasians living in Kuala Kedah, and his common law wife, called Martina Roussels, brought the whole of the school and the church to Bishop Street and Church Street in Penang. I'm saying this very, very consciously because my first point that I'm going to make, that our Lasallian education is relevant only in a certain context. In each era of history, of civilizational development, education must be the first thing that must change in terms of its concept and hopefully in terms of its praxis. So that's how we began in Penang in 1852. Three brothers came to Penang on a boat from Singapore because six of them had come. Three dropped off in Singapore to start a school there. And together with the six brothers came also, very interestingly, five sisters. And that's why the IG sisters always, put their buildings next to us, where they still feel that we educate the boys and hopefully we educate the girls and make them good wives and they good husbands. I'm not joking, I'm serious. So I think this is part of, the holistic education that we thought about.
Yeah.
There's no education without a home.
I would love to get into how Lasallian education has evolved, but just let me fill up all the gaps.
Yes,
first.
Please,
so
please.
The LaSalle brothers, did they stay in Malaysia till the end of the ones who arrived, did they stay here till the end of their lives or did they go back?
No, they didn't stay till the end of their lives. Because after the first 50 years sitting comfortably in Penang, we said, time for us to move. It took 50 years to bear the fruits, not just the tree, the fruits, the flowers were there 50 years. And this is very, very important. We developed a model and replicated that model. So right after the first 50 years, we moved to Malacca, St. Francis, we moved to St. John's, we moved to five schools before independence. And those were all direct replicas of each of our schools. And three characteristics of our schools in those days, because I talked about the Industrial Revolution, this was a colonial era. So right when the brothers took over the schools, we changed the medium of instruction from Malay into English. That was our first contribution to society, because the British colonial government, which supported us a lot right from the beginning, wanted English-speaking civil servants, persons with character, persons with the right values, persons who'd be motivated and to serve the community. And that was our first criteria that defined our school's contextualization and relevance. I'll talk later about the other two parts, which is an integral part of how we move from one school in 1852, exactly 163 years this year. We have 44 schools in Malaysia.
How many schools globally? I mean, regionally, are there 18 other schools?
Yes. We're very, very, not highly organized, very decentralized, participatory system. Whereas we grow, we share resources with others. So from Malaysia, we moved to Myanmar, from St. Joseph's Training College, which was the first teacher's training college for young brothers like us when we were the students. Hong Kong, Sabah, Sarawak, Borneo. So we move from Penang. So education is not to be kept under the temporal. Once we develop a nicely, beautifully, genetically modified, education, we go through the seeds all over Asia. And that has been the power of Lasallian education. And that is not separate from mission schools, because we were the leaders historically. And we have tried all the time to be in the front line, not just in terms of doing, I think more essentially rethinking. I think that is a key word in education. Rethinking, remolding, hopefully transforming.
I never attended a mission school, but I've heard stories about how students were fearful of the overly strict brothers and sisters who ran the place, how they had no hesitation in using the cane which they often carried with them. I ask Brother Anthony this next on the Evening Edition, BFM 89.9.
Be firmly motivated. BFM 89.9.
You're listening to the Evening Edition. I'm Umar Pagadampake Pagan. I'm speaking today to Reverend Brother Anthony Rogers, the FSC Sector Leader, LaSalle Pacific Asian Region Conference, Malaysia. And we've been talking about mission schools in the country with a particular focus on LaSalle schools. So, Brother Anthony, there's this preconceived notion that the brothers and sisters who ran the LaSalle and the convent schools in the country were super strict. They would put the fear of God in students and use the cane liberally to keep students in check. Is this true?
When we talked of being strict, we talk of punishment. I think that for me is the secondary. The primary word is discipline. And we help young people not just discipline through the cane and to reward them with a carrot, but help them to realize their education is about self-discipline. And that's why within the school system, we're the first in that sense to develop a system of, I won't say monitoring, we have class monitors, we have prefects, and that was not the policemen, they were the ones who encouraged, they stood at the door and asked us when he started to arrange our tie properly and to make sure our shoelaces were tight. I think that is part of what I call community. The teacher doesn't have to do anything. It's a peer-oriented, I won't say discipline. Discipline for personal responsibility. And most importantly, I believe the heart and the essence of Lasallian education and hopefully mission education is not just about social mobility. We drum into them. This is not about rising up to the top, but about social responsibility. And that social responsibility can only come if we know how to discipline our lives, not with a carrot, not with a cane. So mistakenly, there were brothers walking around with the cane. I don't know, the sisters walk around with the canes in the convent. But I think this is part of the, not fear, hopefully not fear. When they left, although many of them got a few things on their back, you know, but they realized that, but we will never do that. I myself, when I was in school, I'm very proud, I never used the cane. Because ultimately believe that, it is our own ability to reason that will prevent us from doing wrong and hopefully motivate us to do right.
Let's go back to how parents at the time bought into the idea of enrolling their children into schools. Education wasn't really at the top of their mind. They were busy making a living to survive. Schools were revolutionary then, and like you said, it wasn't the norm for the poor to go to school. So how did the brothers convince parents that children should be in schools, that they should be receiving an education?
So John Baptist himself, when he told the kids, "Hey, I'm bringing you to school, not just to teach you, you go back and change the life of your parents. Go and tell them what is the meaning of your faith, what does it mean to be a good family." If you see the two brothers, siblings coming to the school, they go back home and they're behaving themselves. The father and the mother ask them, "Hey, what's wrong with us? Why are you fighting in front of the kids?" And this is a very, very interesting, and that's why he calls it, we call our education the human and the spiritual education. If we cut one out, you become a human being who's just able to use his reason to create a better world and smart bombs and what have you. And this is where the spiritual education has always been an integral and constitutive part of Lasallian education. So the trick is this. If you want to teach the students, teach them well, go and do that at home.
It's a cycle. Right? Yeah. I mean, it's not a vicious cycle, a virtuous cycle. Yeah.
So the school is not a daycare center?
Yeah.
We dump them with the teachers and ask them to teach? No. And now I think the government's policy today of this thing called Sarana Ibu Bapa, I think it's a fantastic idea. But the only problem is for our PIBG meetings, PTA meetings, very few parents stand up. Why? Because they have subcontracted education to the Ministry of Education, state officials, even to the teachers. And this is where I think our Lasallian schools and our mission schools are trying really, really hard. He says, "Hey, we're keeping your students in school 8 years. When they increase to 10 years, it's a very, very good move." You know why? Because they're practicing and trained to exercise boredom, because that's what working life is about. So I think this is the second aspect of education. As we move along the age, enough of the mass-produced goods of the Industrial Revolution. What is the meaning of education in a globalized ICT world? Our curriculum must change. Not just the content of our teaching, but the process and the pedagogical approaches towards teaching. I'll just give you one little anecdote. I was at a meeting recently, and we were asked, what is the ideal of a Lasallian education? Some people said, must do this, must do this, must do that. Then I, like an idiot, I stood up and said, my ideal Lasalle school will be the students will be in class for 2 hours and have recess for 6 hours. So they thought I'd gone mad. I think that is the essence of education. They learn more outside the classroom than in the classroom. They learn from one another. They can put their iPad there today. They can go home. I love to give 2 days holiday every week to the student. Go and do homeschooling. I go and have community-based learning. Weekends go for picnics, go outing. And that's how our time in school, that's what we did. But I don't know why I became a brother. I saw this guy so happy. Weekends, picnic, I don't think we studied in class. But we enjoyed becoming students who longing to have knowledge, not just for a career, but to be happy in life, to have... Until today, there's the strength of many of our LaSalle schools. Our annual gatherings are more than beer-drinking parties. It started off as that a long time ago. But they come and they can yarn and tell stories. They can still recall, because I believe young people today don't have many moments of joy to share. I think that is the essence of life. And school is supposed to be joyful, not miserable. But today, with all the stress and the competition, So that's my second point, that we need to change our pedagogical approaches in the school and also at home.
And on a global level, the LaSalle brothers are known not only to educate but support and help youths at risk, the underprivileged, drug users, orphans and so on. Is this practiced here as well, or is LaSalle in Malaysia purely focused on education?
We started education for only one reason: for the last, the least and the lost. That's, you know, because John Baptist LaSalle went to the streets of Rouen and Reims in France. So when we came to Asia, the first thing we did was open the doors of our schools. Not one single cent, free. And that is the essence of Lasallian education, and that's for the poor. What form it takes, I'll share a little bit later, but how, besides our 44 so-called Lasallian schools in Malaysia, we're also moving into what we call the margins. I'll share a little bit about how, after 160 years, we've realized that, you know, academic excellence does not mean happiness.
I'm curious, how did the mission school survive over the years? Were there fees charged to students? Was it only based on donations and grants from well-wishers?
I had two levels. First level, right from the beginning, from day one, the colonial government, when we used to, you know, when we ran the school, we used to find our own little monies and all. But when the colonial government literally paid for all of these, that is the first and the most important thing. Secondly, as for the lands that we bought and the buildings that we put, that is the second point. Besides the government, we believe our schools are community-based schools. So the poor kids came, they didn't pay anything, but the rich parents were the ones that really supported us. You know, I can tell you about this famous Hia Chu Siang in Penang, a famous businessman. After the Japanese left, the Americans did us a favor. They bombed the whole building to the ground. So we had to put up a new building. That was in 1954. You know? And every single cent came from public donations. So people are still very, very proud of our schools, because it's not a brother's school. It is a community school. I think this is very important. So now we notice you talk about private-public partnership. We had private-public partnership long, long time ago. And the role of the brothers was, just like the satay seller, just to go and keep the fire going.
We're heading for the news next, but after that, I'll be speaking to Brother Anthony about how mission schools are relevant today and what is being done to support them. Don't go anywhere. This is BFM 89.9.
Audacious, fabulous minds. BFM 89.9. The Business Station.
Good evening, I'm Umar Pagadampake Pagad, and you're listening to the Evening Edition. For the past half an hour or so, we've been speaking to Brother Anthony Rogers about the history of mission schools here in Malaysia and how much they've contributed to our education system. Brother Anthony is the FSC sector leader of the LaSalle Pacific Asian Region Conference in Malaysia, and he's been sharing his thoughts with us about the LaSalle method of teaching and educating. A little bit of historical context again, Brother Anthony. After independence, mission schools and every other school in existence had to adopt a national education system that had its own syllabus. Tell us what that transition was like.
So after independence, 1957, the big event was the Aziz Commission. That literally gave an option to the teachers whether they want a national service. And that's what happened. They became so-called civil servants. That means they had to teach the curriculum not of the school but of the national, which is excellent. Secondly, as the system becomes more centralized, there must be place for greater globalization, globalization. If you don't accept that there are possibilities of new initiatives coming from schools, which the trust schools very ironically are doing, you know, mm-hmm. They're giving back autonomy. Why? Because you trust them. Maybe I won't say the mission schools were not trusted in their attempt to want to homogenize, centralize, because many people think that unity is about uniformity. Unity is not about uniformity. Unity is about diversity. Why can't we allow young people slowly give us greater autonomy? And this is a very interesting move that took place. But after 30 years now, 50 years independence, I think the government is realizing that industrial age education of standardized mass-produced education is not going to work. And that's why the fact that they're allowing, I wouldn't like to call them international schools. They're not international schools. I would call them English medium schools, offering greater freedom. And that's what we did before. Mission schools, LaSalle schools, why did we blossom and grow? Because they allowed at that time English, but at the same time, without negating the fact that we must give importance to mother tongue and national language. I think so it's not a compromise.
Is there still enough or significant government support for mission schools?
There were certain, rights that were taken away. And that rights, not taken away, but maybe we gave them up because we didn't stand by what I said just now about our board of governors and board of managers. That is another form of decentralization. Where the parents come, the teachers come, and the brothers are involved. We get our alumni to be involved. I'm not talking about power. I'm talking of the influence.
Yeah. And the decisions that are important for the school.
Yeah. Minor decisions. Don't have to come and tell us, what to do. But hopefully, we're true Malaysians. That is the starting point. From being a true Malaysian, our inner identity, our external shows of what we are, then I think trust us. I think the word is trust us. So I like the word trust school. Can mission schools become trust schools? Only if they will trust us and entrust us with new responsibilities. So this is not a demand. This is just, I think, a nice little way forward. You can see in our documents and our writings and that we have got a dream. So very briefly, what is the essence of this new transformation? We have got threefold strategy. First is what is called transformation of our schools. Quality education. And what is quality education basically mean? It means holistic. Secondly, we are saying that some of our schools, besides being these academic schools, we are also moving towards developing what we call new Lasallian educational initiatives. And that is introducing within our schools creative, vocational, technical subjects. And there are a whole range of them now on the IGCSE, Cambridge, TAFE in Australia. We are going around picking and collecting all this and coming back and say, oh, boys in Form 4 in St. Xavier's now, they're doing culinary arts. The guys who are sleeping in class, we take them out, and they're bakers, they're in the Form 5 with the SPM. Group of them bring motor mechanics, group of them bring electronics. I think, but we don't want to take them out from our school to send them to technical schools. In fact, I talk to the ministry official. So better you can send them to technical school. We have to keep them in our office. Keep them for full 13 years and so that we'll nurture them with their culture, with their environment, with their ecology that is wholesome. The third is, which for many of us comes back to the first question you asked, that within this system, we are not looking for the high jumpers. We are looking for the guys that are growing. So in all our schools, we start what is called LaSalle Learning Centres. They come in the evening. I won't go into details, but this classroom doesn't have a teacher. It has got 12 desks. And inside each desk, they flip the desk, has got 12 levels of learning. A guy who doesn't recognize alphabets the first day, he looks at the alphabets. Second desk, he looks at the numbers. The third one, he picks up the telephone and answers the telephone. 12 different. Apart of that, they sit and play games. And that is the type of new approach towards not teaching, but learning. I think these are the three, and we're slowly moving into our schools now too. And some of the sister schools have also taken this challenge up. I think they'll be surprised, the kids, such kids, their problem is not teaching or learning. I think for so long they've been told, you're stupid. And they realize, no, I'm not stupid. There are many things I can do.